Thinking Native, 11 Insights for 2011, with your host Saul Kropman from The Digital Edge.
My name is Kevin Lawrence. My native origins are CEO of Cambriant, and my new native role is as the Chief Growth Officer. And what that really means is in charge of client services and business development.
Well, Kevin, we're talking about digital agencies and the state of digital agencies in South Africa. What are the highlights that you can point out for us, and what really stands out for you in digital agencies in South Africa?
Well, I think, Saul, the standout thing for me is in terms of the development of the digital agency business in South Africa, we are at an inflection point, and a very exciting one at that. So the transition that a lot of clients are seeing is that with additional bandwidth and connectivity in South Africa, the number of people that are online either via mobile or via a fixed line internet connection is increasing dramatically. That creates a market for advertisers, and that's the biggest transition we see happening in the next, probably the next 5 years. I'm bullishly thinking about a 500% growth potential in the next 5 years.
If I'm not mistaken, that would put us to about 10% of national ad spend.
Yes, that's quite correct. Yeah. So currently looking at about 2% of national ad spend, which is a fraction of the global average of 14%. I know in Europe, in some European regions, and in particular sectors, it's a lot higher. So if South Africa gets to an average of about 10%, which is still 50% below the global average in the next 5 years, which is obviously going to continue moving, then the landscape for digital agencies in South Africa will have changed significantly.
Well, Kevin, historically, we're sitting at that 2%, which is kind of quite disparate, if you think about it, considering that there's, what about 10% internet penetration in the country? Why do you think that is?
It's a great question, and in fact we've commissioned a research report to ask the people who are spending the money why that is. So we decided to go to the horse's mouth and find out from corporate marketers what the barriers are to spending money online. And I think, without going into the detail of the data that we're going to be revealing through the report, there are some perception issues. There are some education issues, and fundamentally there's a lack of understanding of what the potential is. So like anything new, and for those of us who've been in digital for the last 15 years, it doesn't really feel like it's new, but for a lot of people in traditional marketing positions, it still seems like a new discipline and a bit of a wild frontier that's not as well understood as what the traditional opportunities are.
How are we going to change that perception, since we know that's not entirely true, that it's not a wild frontier?
I think that the perceptions will change over time, through education, through seeing results, through better understanding. So it's not something that's going to happen overnight. But I think what's going to happen, and when we look back in the next 5 years, the shift will be dramatic and impactful, but on a day-to-day basis, it's going to seem like things are moving slower than we'd like them to.
Who do you think is going to actually lose out as a result of the marketing budget for digital growing?
Well, I think there's a very obvious casualty there, and broadly, it's going to be traditional media. It's not like the marketing budgets are going to grow to the degree that the money shifts out of traditional into digital. So what it means is that it's going to cannibalize the traditional budgets in favor of digital. Within traditional budgets, there are going to be, for different sectors, bigger or smaller casualties. Obviously, newspapers and print in general are under tremendous pressure, and those are probably the areas that will internationally have seen the biggest decline. In South Africa, maybe newspapers are a bit more shielded because of the emerging economy nature of who we are, but generally the floods or the move's going to be from digital, from traditional media into digital media.
Just going back to clients, do you think a big problem is in fact that digital is so broad? You know, there's so many different aspects of it. There's creative, there's actual building of sites, there's SEO. You know, I could go on for hours talking about the different aspects of it. Do you think that's a big problem?
It is. You know, the one of the challenges that clients face, just to kind of put the client hat on for a second, is they're used to dealing with, their usual environment is one consolidated relationship with the lead agency. So structurally, that's how they deal with their day. Within that lead agency environment, they're very well understood, mature channels and processes that have been established over literally decades. So, you know, when you talk to a traditional marketer about making a TV commercial, you know, all of them have done it. They understand it, they understand how it works, they understand the mechanics, they understand the language, they understand the jargon around making a TV commercial. But like you accurately say, the fragmentation and the noise around the different opportunities in digital is deafening to a lot of people. You know, should they be tweeting, shouldn't they be tweeting? You know, 2 years ago, tweeting was something that birds did. So it was difficult for clients now to adopt that as part of their daily marketing arsenal. So, and I think the challenge is that the trend's going to continue. I mean, if we look forward 5 years, there's going to be five more Twitter-like phenomenons that have arisen that aren't evident today. So for clients, it's very, very challenging for them to not only keep up with what's going on, but also to filter the hype and the nonsense out of what they should really be paying attention to, and then to think of a strategy, and it has to be an integrated strategy, to deploy those new opportunities in a way that makes sense to their targeted markets and their brands.
What about Native? I mean, what are they going to be offering in terms of the different online and digital services?
We've made a very clear play as to where we think the future lies. So our offering is an integrated digital offering. And when you look at the way, there's really two broad opportunities for a client in the market today. The one opportunity is to work with a syndicate of agencies that are representative of different disciplines. So we participate in a number of syndicates where you have a mixture of media buying agencies, social media agencies, creative agencies, more technical agencies, email marketing agencies, that all take a slice of the portfolio and execute on that. So that's definitely an opportunity. On the other end of the spectrum, this notion of a full-service digital agency is the alternative. And full-service implies lead. So what that means is that you take the digital disciplines and you put them under one umbrella and have one party accountable for integrating all of those disciplines and delivering, at least on the digital level, a fully integrated campaign. And that's Native's play. Unequivocally, we are positioning as a lead digital agency to clients that want to embrace that service. The opportunity there really is to lower the communication overhead and risk of non-integration through a looser affiliation of agencies that work on a particular brand.
I guess for a lot of people it's one invoice.
Yeah, I mean there's lots of efficiencies. Yeah. I mean just think of the accounting efficiencies, just think of the briefing efficiencies, just think of the coordination efficiencies. So we're very, very clear that that is one opportunity, but we're not for one second saying that that's the only opportunity, because there are existing relationships that clients have with other agencies that we happily participate in and provide only a portion of our services in a niche way into those accounts. So just because our vision is to integrate services under one brand, the brand of Native, and to bring those efficiencies to bear on an account, we don't think it's the only way it's going to work.
You mentioned earlier that strategy when it comes to digital is incredibly important, and it's very different to, say, traditional. What would differentiate Native in terms of how they provide strategy for clients?
Our strategic approach has got a couple of real non-negotiable fundamentals that we want to hold ourselves to account to. And I think the first one is that when you look at any brand and you look at the potential strategy to promote that brand to a targeted consumer base, the first thing is the strategy needs to be born digital. We believe fundamentally that if we take a bottom-up approach to strategy, and instead of saying start with a broadcast message and see how we can apply that broadcast message to a digital implementation of that message, and rather say let's come up with a digital idea and support it with traditional media, we believe that coming up with a born digital idea is fundamental, and using traditional as a support for that idea.
You mentioned also about how, you know, you guys go into a company with a sort of syndicate of different agencies. When it comes to traditional agencies, who are you going to be going with? Is there an agency that you specifically will be partnering with, or is it, again, there'll be different syndicates?
Again, it's a bit of both. So in terms of some successes we've had recently, one of the things that we see in the agency landscape is that traditional agencies face some challenges. And the challenge is, one of the biggest challenges is, what do they do with digital? Because there's obviously a lot of choices to make there. So the one choice is, we're going to build it ourselves organically inside our organization. For a client, that's very appealing because they're dealing with their main agency. They've got that trust relationship, they understand their brands, and here's another service that just gets bolted on. That's one opportunity. And with those agencies, there's very little opportunity for us to partner because we're seen as a competitive threat to those internal departments. Then you've got other agencies that want to conceptualize all of the work and then just outsource the production. And we've had some success, and we're actively working on some accounts with agencies like that. And then recently we've formed a relationship with one agency that's embraced us as their digital partner, Publicis, where we formed a relationship with them to pitch on work as the lead digital agency. And we've had some success there already with Brand South Africa that we won jointly in a pitch.
For a client, what's the approach? I mean, why would they use a joint digital agency and traditional agency as opposed to one sort of integrated agency?
The integrated agency story is definitely a better story. If you look at a scratch under the hood of what a digital agency inside a traditional agency looks like, we've got to ask questions about breadth of services and depth of experience. Just having five guys sitting in the corner is not necessarily going to be sufficient to service big brands on the digital platform. I mean, our agency is now quite big. We've got 120 people, which is bigger than some traditional agencies. And the reason that that's happening is because the demands that are being expected by clients are escalating, and you've got to have the infrastructure, the processes, the people, the diversity of skills, and importantly the depth of skills to be able to respond to those demands. So an integrated agency is definitely a better story because it sounds like it's easier, but the components also have to be world-class in their own right. So probably one of the good questions to ask is, could that digital agency win work on its own, with its own credibility, apart from that mother brand? And if the answer is no, a client should probably ask the question, well, you know, is there better service I can get elsewhere by looking for a specialist digital agency as opposed to something that's a component of a traditional agency?
They're jack of all trades, master of none.
There's a lovely analogy in the future of advertising that says that if you look at the orientation of your agency and they use a metaphor for building a house. You know, if you go to a carpenter, the likelihood of you getting a wooden house is quite good. So if you go to a traditional agency that's got a digital component to it, the likelihood of getting a traditional campaign is very good. And that's still a challenge for clients.
Sure.
You know, with the best will in the world, if you've got 300 people who are traditional agency thinkers and you know, a small component of those people are digital thinkers, the likelihood of a traditional agency being able to overcome its legacy and its history of real deep competence and real deep experience in traditional media and letting that, putting that aside to come up with pure digital thinking, it's just unlikely.
What is the difference, though, between traditional and digital thinking?
Well, I think one of the fundamental differences is that when you look at the way that a digital idea permeates an agency, one of the challenges that traditional agencies face is in their economic model. A lot of what digital does fundamentally threatens the way that traditional agencies make their money. So it's maybe a naive, unfair, unresearched view, but the view is nonetheless that traditional agencies make most of their money by making TV commercials, because that's where the big production budgets are, that's where the big media budgets are. So if that's the case, if your economic model is premised on creating a particular kind of communication, the economic necessity is to drift and to point your clients towards that type of communication. And it'll probably be a very easy exercise to do if you looked at, you know, income statements of various companies to see where the money comes from and the imperative to keep money flowing in that direction. So the challenge for them is to say, well, can we forsake our economic engine to come up with an idea that could exclude all of those disciplines? And that's the biggest challenge.
So digital is more ideas than pretty pictures, I suppose.
Well, digital, I think the way to say it is that digital is definitely less media. Mm-hmm. So you can get away with reaching more people with less paid media than you can in the traditional world. In fact, in the traditional world, unless you're doing a stunt on the corner of William Nicol, it's going to be pretty hard to get unpaid media. I mean, PR, I suppose, is the best example of unpaid media. Mm-hmm. So and So where digital, you know, you can come up with something that goes viral, where you use free platforms, that you can build functionality that people fall in love with and use on a more platform basis than a campaign basis, and that creates opportunities to create engagement without paying a media tax on top of that. And that's very different to the way the traditional agencies work. So I think digital is more about building stuff than about buying space.
I'm kind of getting the impression, rather build your own platforms that people will come to as a almost advertorial, as opposed to just shoving as many adverts on a billboard somewhere.
Yeah, I mean, maybe to say it more strongly than that, because this is a fundamental belief that we have in the way that we're thinking about the future of our clients' businesses, is it's platform thinking versus campaign thinking. Mm. So campaign thinking is very much about, you know, keep adding media money and they will come. Platform thinking is try and make something that people want to engage with. Now, there are very few adverts that people want to engage with because they traditionally have been positioned as interruptions in your day. But the opportunity in digital is to create a functional, engaging experience for a consumer base that A, they enjoy using, that's fun, that's entertaining, that's useful, and B, that they talk about, which is your word of mouth opportunity, you know, bundled into that platform. Yeah. And C, you know, if they find it useful today, the likelihood of them finding it useful in 6 months to a year's time is quite good. So if you do it right, you can build a platform that people continue to use, continue to love, that's useful over a number of years, as opposed to a campaign burst where, you know, even if the adverts are a Cannes Lion winning piece of work, you know, you look at it 100 times and it's going to become annoying.
But at the same time, surely native's going to be doing campaign work.
Native will be, but one of our fundamental departure points is there potential in this campaign to either support a platform or to build a platform? Because the eye-watering thing about some of the traditional budgets, and it goes back to the 2% argument, is that, you know, take the cost of a TV commercial and you can actually build a pretty significant piece of infrastructure with that kind of budget.
Are there any examples of those advertorial type sites that we mentioned that you guys have built that you'd like to mention?
Yeah, I think one of the ones that we most proud of in terms of its current form and very positive about in terms of its future potential, there's two in particular. The one is Pick and Pay. If we were to copy the traditional ad model for Pick and Pay, which is a brand commercial and a broadsheet, that didn't make for very engaging web content. So the platform that we created in partnership with another digital agency, Aqua, was the Fresh Living Network. And our new CEO of Native was also intimately involved in conceptualizing the Fresh Living Network, which is a lifestyle portal for the good provider, as the Pick and Pay shop has been termed. So the utility around that is around recipes, what am I going to cook? When I decide what I'm going to cook, helping that shopper get that list of ingredients onto your shopping list. And then when you're in the shop, helping you navigate the many aisles in the Pick and Pay to find that particular little spice that you need. Yeah. So there's utility there. I guess the thing that we're excited about in terms of the current adoption is that it's been quite good. And the future adoption, you know, are people still going to be interested in shopping and recipes in a year time? Absolutely. The other one that I was going to mention is South African tourism. Because South African tourism, we've built a web portal focusing on different segments, and we're campaigning around that portal to bring people more information, more content, more insight into what South Africa has to offer. So again, you know, you look forward 3 years, portal's still going to be relevant, content volumes are going to be higher, visitor volumes are going to be higher, email subscriber lists are going to be higher, so the platform potential there is very, very clear.
Are you going to be working with a lot of other digital agencies now that you've merged together?
Yeah, I don't think that philosophy changes at all. We are currently working with other digital agencies, and the digital industry is small. So, you know, we've had instances where we currently engaged on accounts with digital agencies, and then we have a status meeting on Monday and we pitch against them on Tuesday. And we're just going to be grown up about it, because that's the truth of the industry and that's the way that things are. And ultimately, that's the client's requirements that form the structure of the digital relationship. And we're very comfortable fitting in a place that's appropriate where we can add value.
Kevin, if you're a client, if you could put yourself in the client's shoes, how would you actually rate a digital agency and how would you choose one for your company?
So I think the first thing for me, when I look at an opportunity with a client, what we want to do is we want to solve that client's problem. It's really a business question. If a client has a particular challenge that they need to overcome and they think that digital marketing or digital in general offers an opportunity to overcome that problem, I would pick the supplier that has the best story or the best proposition as to how they would solve that problem. And really, it's all about results at the end of the day. So we want to go with clients that have a clear understanding of what they need and are very determined to meet those objectives by investing appropriately in services to do that.
Kevin, you keep on mentioning things like an agency story. What is Native Story?
Native Story is that we have a one-liner that we use to measure ourselves and inform our clients as to what we do. And that one-liner is, our goal is to help our customers build, or our clients, sorry, build deep relationships with their customers. And that's something that's very tangible and measurable. And it also informs the way we go about doing what we do. So we're not just about broadcast. We're not just about clever ideas. Hopefully we've got those too. We are about putting a message out there that's appropriate to a brand, that resonates with a particular target audience, that we can eventually use to as the starting point to engage with that audience and to form a relationship where we can talk to them for the next, hopefully, 20 years. And that for us is a fundamental, solid, business-centric approach to what we do.
That brings us to the consistent question of, why would I want to target the audience with digital if there's not that many people online?
Well, I just think that there are people online. That's just the bottom line. If we're ignoring 10 million just on the internet, 10 million users of the internet that are in the high LSMs in South Africa, anyone who's saying that, there's just no hope. Mm-hmm. And particularly when you add the mobile component to that, which is even bigger. And I would argue that even if, and in some sectors that probably is true, you know, you've got certain products where your audience is maybe not, you can still argue that you can reach them in other ways. But it's not going to be that way forever. If we think forward again 5 years, we're talking about a totally connected society. And really, you've got to get your game on now and start practicing this thing. You can't say, oh, in 5 years I'm going to wake up and I'm going to suddenly switch from doing what I was doing yesterday to doing something completely different tomorrow. It's an evolution, and there's learning during that evolution.
Are you going to be the ones educating the clients?
Definitely. Yes. Education is fundamental to our strategy. We see it as our obligation to engage with our clients not only on a pitch level and a proposal level, but also on an educational level where we can share thoughts, we can understand their challenges, and we can debate issues that are relevant to the industry and relevant to their businesses.
Kevin, what do you think clients are looking for in 2011?
I think that my sense of what I've heard from the clients that we deal with is that their expectation is growing. They're certainly becoming more confident in terms of what they are going to ask for out of digital, and they're feeling this groundswell of more excitement and more energy being put into digital. So I think they are going to expect more across the spectrum of services that they are wanting to engage with, and within those different service verticals, they're going to expect a higher level of delivery.
Kevin, is the message I'm getting from you, if you don't go to digital now, you're going to be left behind?
Yeah, look, I think if you haven't started, you're already behind, but being behind doesn't mean you have to stay there. So it's not, I'm not a big fan of generalizations in terms of who's behind or who's not, because you can pull out very compelling case studies to say that it's, you know, I am or I'm not behind in terms of my particular brand goals. I think what was absolutely vital is just to do a sanity check and to interrogate where your market is for your product and service and to see what the opportunities are. And you know what, if you talk to people who can't give you an insight into how digital can help your brand and reach your audience and engage with them, then if there are no good stories or no good opportunities there or no good offers for you, then don't do anything.
That informs budgets and where to put your money. Would it be mobile? Would it be more online and on a desktop web as opposed to mobile?
Absolutely. So the budgeting question is a good one, because when you look at traditionally how budgets are allocated inside corporates that have the kind of marketing spend that warrants dealing with large digital agencies, you see that the budgeting process is traditionally quite a rigid one, and it's often the overall process is an incremental one. So it's quite hard, you know, to go to your chief financial officer and say we've got to put money into Twitter, because he's not going to really know what's going on there. So it's difficult to shift things dramatically, and that's why it's more of an incremental shift. Having said that, once you have your pot of money, however big it is, it's absolutely fundamental to strategically allocate that money, to say that we believe and we understand that our audience is in on one platform or another, and then allocate money appropriately to those platforms, and that would give you inform your digital desktop interaction versus your mobile interaction.
Where would you find research like that, as to sort of where your customer is? Would Native be able to do that for you?
Yeah, we certainly could provide some insight. I think in a lot of instances, marketing departments will know more than they think they know about where their people are. I think that question is really is actually easier to answer than most people think, and it's not something that is a barrier to entry. I think what's more challenging is you know where they are, but to know what they think and what they're really interested in. That's the deeper question that has to be answered so that you know what to say to them.
What about the actual competitive landscape of digital agencies in South Africa? Who keeps you up at night?
Well, there's significantly skilled and well-resourced agencies out there. There's probably, you know, the top 10 that we bump into all the time. At the top of the pile has to be, Brent and his Aqua team. They've been around a very long time. They've got, they're well capitalized now. They've got a big parent. So they certainly are a formidable competitor and a well-respected competitor. Glue is legendary in terms of its creative abilities and the awards that it's won, so we can never discount them. And then, Quirk pops up on regular occasion in various pitches. So those are the known entities. I think that the unknown entities for us are probably the ones that are more concerning, sort of the agencies that are tucked away under the cover of a large traditional agency, because we're just not getting to talk to those customers, because they're shielded from any outside outwardly looking view by the traditional agencies.
In terms of your goals for the first year, what are you aiming towards in terms of clients and growing the business?
In terms of our clients, the number one priority for us with the merger is to make sure that our current customers and their respective marketing teams are comfortable, well integrated into our new structure. So we've got a lot of inward looking stuff to do to make sure that our client service teams and our production teams are delivering to the standard and hopefully exceeding the expectations of our current customers. In any agency business, you can't afford to have a leaky bucket and have clients flowing out of your organization. So that's without a doubt our number one priority, and that's going to take up a lot of time.
Is the aim to provide, say, for example, Cambrian services to brandish clients and vice versa?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. The opportunity to offer an existing client additional services that we weren't able to offer in the past is definitely an objective. Having said that, though, in some instances, the individual companies are contracted in structures and relationships that prohibit that happening. So we're in a syndicate, for example, at South African Tourism. We have very defined service lines that we offer there, and our contract is something that we take very seriously and we honor in terms of the services that we offer and we don't offer. So it's a combination of those two things. But where we've got clients where there are no contractual barriers to offering additional services, it's absolutely our strategy to do that.
Are there any trends you're looking forward to specifically in 2011?
I don't think there's any one trend that I could pick out. I do have a sense that there is just more awareness. There's just more demand. There's just higher expectations, which we obviously delighted about. I mean, we want the industry to grow. We want our clients to get more value. We want to do better work. We want to be more adventurous. So there's a growing confidence. So maybe the trend is growing confidence and a little less recession blues, which is going to be most welcome.
If you had to make a prediction in terms of the growth of the market, would you be able to give a percentage growth?
Yeah, I think as we were saying earlier, in terms of the percentages, we've got to look at the overall sector growth. So my logic or very sort of rudimentary rationale would be to say, if we go to 10% of advertising spend in 5 years, it would be unbelievable, because we're all surviving at the moment on under 2%. Mm. And I think it would probably, you know, if you look at the production mix, when you add that in, it would probably be significantly more than just the growth in media spend, because there's all these other disciplines that would also float with the rising tide.
What growth factors would actually affect that percentage?
I think that the growth of the online market, in terms of the number of consumers there, the decline of broadband costs was a significant factor. And also the you know, what's interesting when we deal with multinationals is the way that they allocate budget. So a significant opportunity is when multinationals saying something like, start saying like, we are allocating 15% of our marketing budget to digital. That suddenly makes it happen in a very, very rapid way, where we haven't defined yet how that money is going to be spent, but we know where we want to target that spend. And so there's almost a someone's waiting for someone to do something, and we've heard it a couple of times now in the last, particularly the last half of this year, where multinationals have started to say, we're going to make an allocation of significantly more budget. And I think what that's going to do is make digital more visible, and then the local players are also going to say, well, gee, that's what's happening from our international competitors and our international peers. We need to be moving in the same direction.
Speaking of multinationals, while you wait for the local market to grow even further, will you be looking overseas for client work?
I'm not at this stage, Saul. I think that, you know, I had a very, I suppose it was a bit of a reality check when I spoke to one of my agency compatriots, who mentioned that, and I'll use his quote, you guys are a dime a dozen in the US and Europe, which you know, no one likes to hear, but it's a good realization that because we are, our market is less mature than international markets. I mean, we don't have, you know, any RGA kind of level work coming out of South Africa yet. We're not really competitive in those markets, and even with a rand arbitrage opportunity, which is probably less than it was a couple of years ago, our opportunity is really in emerging markets and South Africa, Africa, and maybe, you know, looking at South America, although those are very competitive markets as well. It's not, I don't think international work is needed to grow a business to the scale that we want to grow our business to.
You mentioned RGA, and there was Chris Colborne in the country from RGA a few months ago. Is the problem, the reason we're not making work as amazing as, for example, RGA, is that a client problem or is that an agency problem?
Without sounding like a cop-out, I think it's, well, in fact, let me not sound like a cop-out. I think it's an agency problem. Okay. I think if we are able to conceptualize campaigns that are as brave as what they have done, then we would, you're not going to land everyone, because not every client is as brave as that, but someone will do it. Some client will make that leap and become famous because of it. So I think that it's got to be driven from the agency side. Agencies can't go around blaming clients for bad work.
So Kevin, just in closing, I mean, is there any message you'd like to give to your clients and potential clients?
Yeah, Saul, I think that the overall excitement that we feel, it comes from three places. The first place is that we're in an industry that's going to grow, and it's going to grow because it's doing stuff that is important, and it's taking responsibility for a very, very fundamental part of any business, which is the communication between a client, our client, and their customer. And because we're doing important stuff, and because the industry is doing important stuff, there's opportunity there. So we're very excited about that, and clients should be excited about that. There's opportunities for them to do things differently. I think the second thing that's really exciting is that in South Africa in particular, because we've had this lag effect, we are able to look forward to what's happening in international markets and see that the future is quite rosy. And then thirdly, the native team is a confluence of some really skilled and seasoned digital veterans. And collectively, what I'm looking for in 2011 is the 1+1 makes 3 factor, where we can align all of our operational and logistical and staff and mindset and all of those elements, which are going to allow us to run much faster and do much better than we would have been able to do on our own. And that's a tremendous opportunity to come back to after a Christmas break.
Thinking Native is a part of The Making of Native, a 4-month journey into the making of South Africa's newest full-service agency.
For more insights with Native's leading thinkers, visit us on www.native.co.za or follow us on @nativespeak.